to cloud. Okay. So tonight's topic is Esther, and it's going to be about her identity. And I want to go on a journey together to kind of let's meet Esther as a person. So before we launch into meeting her, a couple of questions about Megillat Esther. Maybe you've thought of this or heard a class on this, but they're glaring issues. First of all, a very common thing discussed is that there is no God in the Megillah. God is not mentioned. There's no Hashem. There's no Almighty. There's no deity. There's no prayer. The next level down of the fact that there's no God is that there's actually also no religion. There's the Jewish people and peoplehood and nationhood, but religion actually doesn't come up until commentary, when they talk about, there are different commentaries that talk about Esther wanting to keep Shabbat and keeping kosher, but that's actually not in the actual text. It's not there, which we'll see. We're going to look further into two parts of this. One of them is that this very much opens on the Persian Empire, not where all of the Jewish people living. This is in the days of the King Ahasuerus and when he was reigning. It doesn't say, you know, when this person was ruling Judea and this person was ruling in Israel. This is very much in the Persian Empire. It's a little different for what we usually have in our canon. And then I'm going to actually bring up, if anyone's heard of the Septuagint editions of the Esther Apocrypha, that there were additions added into Esther around the 3rd century BCE that actually add elements like Esther praying to God and Mordechai praying to God and all these other Jewish elements and God in general is added into the text, which is fascinating because it makes it so much more glaring. If someone added it in 3rd century BCE, why don't we have it in our Torah? So those are all questions that I'm hoping to answer by the end of the hour. So let's first look at Esther. Let's say, you know, section one, let's meet Esther. So the first time we meet her, it's actually in chapter two, not chapter one, because the whole chapter one is just setting the scene of Ahasuerus and Vashti. I don't know if my kids are sleeping yet. So if one of them crawls down here, I might have to put myself on mute for a second. Although my husband's supposed to be on alert to catch them before they find me. Okay, so we're going to look at, and if you want to follow in a Chumash, you can. We're really mostly going to be looking at the text of Esther. So here we have in Pasuk, Hey, Vav, and Zion, 5, 6, and 7 of chapter 2, we're introduced to Mordechai. Ish Yehudi haya b'Shushan HaBira. He was a Jewish man in the city. Ushmo Mordechai ben Yair ben Shimi ben Kish Ishimini. They say this is Mordechai and all of his lineage. Asher Higlam Yerushalayim. He himself was carried away. He was exiled from Yerushalayim with Yechoniah, the king of Yehuda. Nebuchadnezzar. So this is putting into context that Mordechai was one of the Jews that had to leave. And now we finally get to Esther. But he omein at Hadassah, and he was the He was the guardian of Hadassah. He was the one that reared Hadassah. He brought her up. Who's Hadassah? Esther bat Dodo. This is also who we will learn later is Esther, his niece. Ki ein la avaim, she was orphaned, she didn't have a father or a mother, but she was a beautiful woman. Bahanara yafat toar v'tovat mar'eh uvamot, and that she was this beautiful woman. So far, all we know about Esther is within context of Mordechai. It doesn't say we have this young, beautiful Jewish woman living in Persia. It says, here's this man and here's his lineage, here's his history. He came from Yerushalayim and he happens to have this beautiful niece. So she's very much introduced in the context of who she is in relationship to Mordechai. And if that's not nondescript enough, it says how she didn't have a father or mother. Where are we up to? Sorry. Vilakha Mordechai lo labat, and Mordechai took her as his daughter. meaning she didn't, it doesn't, it's a very passive role that Mordechai, all she is so far is this person in relationship to Mordechai, and he just takes her as a daughter. He adopts her, which is a wonderful thing. So it was when in Pasuk 8, they were all the king's commandment that he wants to remarry, and they start gathering all of the women. Vatilakach Esther, this is Pasuk Chet, Vatilakach Esther el Beit HaMelech, I'm sorry, el Yad Hagai Shomer HaNashim, and again, Esther was taken into the king's house, into the custody of Haggai, who was supposed to watch over all of the women. So again, she was introduced in context of Mordechai. Mordechai has adopted her, again, passive as a daughter. And now the king's guard takes her to the palace. Esther doesn't say who her nation is, who her birthright is. This is all Pasuk Yod, I'll highlight it there. Maybe it seems a little bit like Esther's starting to get active, like, oh, she's not going to tell anyone who her identity is. But then it says, why? Because Mordechai commanded her not to. So then the final Pasuk kind of ends with, final pasuk I present ends with she's taken into the palace and Mordechai is worried about her. He raised her. He was worried about her under his wing. This Jewish girl in the palace. And so Mordechai, can you imagine how anxious he is? It says that Mordechai walked every day. U'b'chol yom Mordechai mitalef l'nechatzer beit hanashim. Every day he would walk back and forth in front of the women where they were being kept for the king. L'dat et shalom Esther, to know how Esther was doing, what was going on with her. U'ma yaseh ba, he's so worried. You feel his pain. This poor, he's horrified of what's happened to Esther. If we were to, let's say, you know, meet her on the street, and this is all that we know about Esther, the vision we're given is of this like edelmadel, meek Jewish girl that she's just really protected. She's really cared for and loved. And we don't really see her personality yet. Her personality is subsumed as part of her family and part of Mordechai, and she's somewhat being captive of the king. And his whole world. We see, you know, I'm sorry, I forgot to check. You know what? I don't know if I can see the chat while I'm screen sharing. I apologize. There we go, chat. Okay, so if anyone has any thoughts or questions, please feel free. I'm going to keep the chat right there so I can see it. Right there. Okay. Okay. So Esther, let's keep going. I'm going to see. Esther's personality continue. So she gets to the palace. And the way that, I don't know if any of you have done a close reading, it's that the women were taken for 12 months into basically a harem of women. They would call them the harem of virgins. And they were given 12 months to make themselves beautiful, to prepare themselves for the role of being the queen. And it wasn't actually that they would prepare themselves for the role of being the queen. It was really the role of being taken before the king and if he liked them or not. And so now we get to the point where it's Esther's turn. So Pasuk, this is a section two, Esther's transition. So Pasuk 15, Tetvav. Bahagia Tor Esther, and it's the turn of Esther. Who is Esther at this point? Bat Avichail Dod Mordechai. She's a daughter of this woman named Avichail, the uncle Mordechai. She's very much the Jew at this point. They're not calling her Hadassah, which is her Jewish name. They're calling her Esther, which is her Persian name, but this is who she's identifying as. Asher lakach lo labat lavo el hamelech. They had taken her for a daughter, again, the very passive, and now she's brought before the king. Lo biksha davar ki im et asher yomar hagai siris hamelech shomer nashim. That she hadn't asked for anything. All the women were actually allowed to ask for ointments and makeup and perfume, things that they would want to prepare themselves before the king. And Esther says, I don't want anything. I want to go with myself. And everyone, she sought favor in everyone's eyes. Everyone really liked her. I'm going to go back to that in a minute. But it says, again, Esther was taken. It's just this this image of Esther is this really this poor girl. Vatilakach pasuk tet zayin to 16. Vatilakach Esther el melech Achashverosh. She's taken to the king of Achashverosh. Pasuk yod zayin. Vayahav hamelech et Esther mikol hanashim. He loved her beyond all the other women. Vimlachecha. I bolded that word, that he made her queen. Again, we're just fitting into the passive here. I'm going to get through the passive part soon. We'll see Esther burst forth. That he made her queen instead of Vashti. And they make this great big feast, and it's so exciting. They get gathered together, and Pasuk Chaf on the bottom of page 1, Pasuk 20, we again in Esther. That Esther did not yet tell anyone about her heritage, about her Judaism, just as she was commanded. So again, we're like, oh, she's starting to get a little bit active. But again, she's like, no, I have to remember what Mordechai told me. I'm not telling anyone about my lineage, just as she was brought up. So also, I'll point out, it says twice so far in Pasuk 10 of chapter 2, right? Oops. Chapter 2 right here, Lo Higid Esther. Esther didn't tell anyone her identity. And again, in Pasuk 20, she did not tell about her lineage just as she was commanded. So why doesn't she reveal her identity? So the commentaries pick up on this a lot, and they go in all sorts of directions. Rashi says, because we know Rashi bases a lot of things on Midrash. So Rashi says that Esther, if you go through Mordechai's lineage and she's the niece, you actually can connect it all the way to King Shaul, and that it was actually, the purpose was to hide her royal lineage so that she would be less endearing to the king. Because if the king knew that one of the women in his harem was actually royal, he would say, well, this is perfect. It's befitting of me. And it's actually a way of making her less attractive to be this person, to be the queen. Ibn Ezra is a different commentator. And he actually has a couple of different suggestions, and he settles with number 3, his third suggestion, that she actually hid her lineage so that she would be favored in front of the king. Meaning he thinks that Mordechai knew she wouldn't be able to control whether or not she was taken or not, but whether or not she can keep kosher and keep Shabbat. If she keeps it on the down low and she keeps her identity quiet, then maybe she can keep all of the halachot and keep being a Jew in the palace if she keeps her identity quiet. What's interesting about this is both Rashi and Ibn Ezra see her hiding her identity for completely the complete polar opposite reason. But also that Ibn Ezra starts talking about halacha, that Esther needs to keep Shabbat and keep kosher, and it doesn't come up at all. One of the most glaring things here is that Esther is intermarrying. And I didn't mention before, stays intermarried, which we'll address later as well. One thing, this is probably a whole nother shear onto itself. I just thought this was fascinating, so I just wanted to make this point. Really interesting note. Is that we actually have 2 other times in the Torah. I'm going to reveal it in a bit so I can let you guys think about this. 2 other times in the Torah where we have a similar story, that there's a future savior of the Jewish people who is watched over by a relative until they are taken in by a royal family. So one of them is Moshe Rabbeinu, that he was in the basket in the Sea of Reeds, and his sister Miriam watches over him until Bat Paro, the daughter of Paro, saves him, and he ends up becoming the savior of the Jewish people. The other story is not as clear cut, but Yosef. When Yosef finds favor in the eyes of the Egyptian masters and he becomes second in command to Potiphar, So you can either say Esther is second in command, as she's the queen of Persia, but Mordechai himself also becomes second in command by the end, and Mordechai takes him in. So I just, that's definitely a share for another time. I just thought that that was really interesting that we do have this motif does repeat about having this future savior kind of being taken in and one of the royal family in order to save the Jewish people. So I just want to look back though at this middle section of Esther's transition, because we kind of painted Esther as extremely passive, but there are hints here that she's actually starting to change. Her personality is starting to come out. So we're showing that her 12-month transition, that she's either becoming queen or potentially becoming queen, it's all of them were getting ready. So first of all, she went along with the process. She isn't putting up a fight, which you could say is passive, but maybe it's part, inaction is also action. So not only is she going along with the process, but we saw in Pasuk 15, Tetvav, that I underlined that she was, Vetehi Eser Nis'et Chen Be'enei Kol Ro'aha, that she obtained favor in the eyes of everyone who knew her and saw her. She was clearly playing the long game here. That she went along with the process. She was learning to break into the culture. She was having everyone everyone really liked her, and she also finding favor in someone's eyes. It doesn't mean everyone thought she was beautiful. It means that she was endearing to them, that they liked her. So maybe this is Esther actually starting to understand the culture of the palace, understand the culture of Persia, because she was so Jewish before and so sheltered in Mordechai's world. And she doesn't let go of her identity. I don't want to take away from the fact that it says, V'lo higida Esther, Esther didn't tell her identity. Okay, so Mordechai told her not to do that, but that also took guts for her to do. She did not reveal her identity. And even after she was chosen as queen, she decided to keep it quiet. And we see how maybe she's really struggling with this identity of being the Jew and being the Persian queen, because the first time it really introduces Esther on her own merit as part of the Jewish lineage is right before she's taken to the king in Pasuk 15, that Esther comes, Bat Avichail Dod Mordechai, to come before the king. So we already are starting to see this kind of clash of these two parts of who she was and who she's becoming. This sheltered Jew who's now stepping into this extremely secular royal role as potentially the queen. And she's gonna now have to struggle with that. She has to figure out, what do I do here? How am I going to straddle these two things that are seemingly extremely opposing to each other? So if we jump to chapter 4, this is page 2, Esther Perek Dalet, we really see the struggle that she feels. So this is after the edict that Haman has convinced Mordechai that all of the Jews need to be killed. And Haman has convinced Achashverosh that all of the Jews need to be killed. And Mordechai, he's a leader of the Jewish people. He is distraught, and we see how upset he is in this first pasuk. O Mordechai yadat kol asher na'asa. He knew everything that had been done. Vayikra Mordechai et begadav. That Mordechai, I'll highlight it here. Mordechai tore his clothing. Vayilbash sak ve'efer. He puts on sackcloth filled with ashes. Vayetze betoch ha'ir. And he goes out into the middle of the city. Vayizak ze'akagadola mara. And he cries this great embittered cry. I mean, he's really putting on a show. Not disingenuous, meaning he's really showing how upset he is. And he's going out and he's crying. And he runs to Esther and he says, oh, my niece is in the palace. This is perfect timing. And of course, there's a lot of commentary there. Maybe Mordechai knew that he had a prophecy that this was going to happen. Maybe he's just taking advantage of my niece is there already. Let's try to get the Jewish people saved. Esther goes ahead and he speaks to the guards to give Esther this message. And in Pasuk 8, it says he actually, he goes to give her v'natan lo laharot et Esther uhu lahagidala. He gives her the decree. He wants them to hand Esther the decree. Oops, I highlighted the wrong part. Here we go. And he's like, to declare unto her and to tell her, ulitzvot ota, and to command her to go before the king and to petition for the Jewish people. So Esther is still treating his niece, who's the queen, as his niece, as the same little girl that grew up in his home. And he's saying, I'm demanding Esther to go do these things. I'm not saying he's in the wrong. The Jewish people were, their lives were at stake here. But the interesting part is that Esther from Perek 1 would have said, of course, right? She was in his embrace. She was his niece. She was like a daughter to him. Some midrashim say wife. Maybe that complicates the relationship a little bit, but I guess marriages back then were also different than they are now. He's going and he's commanding her to go to the king. Let's get this done. Like, we got to change stuff. So what's her response? Vayavo Hatach v'yaged l'Esther. So Hatach is the guard that gives her the message. And he tells Esther everything that he says. In Pasuk 10, Vatomer Esther lahatach, Esther turns back to him, Vatitzavehu al Mordechai. This is what you should go and say back to Mordechai. You know, in Pasuk 11, Kol avdei hamelech v'imidinot hamelech yodim, everyone knows, all of the people and all of the lands know, Asher kol ish v'asher yashar lavo el hamelech, any person that comes before the king, to his inner gate, El Hachatzar Punimit Asher Lo Yikra, that was not called by the king, Lahamit, he's gonna be put to death. And if the king doesn't reach out his scepter, then they will die. Va'ani lo nikreti lavo el hamelech. I'm not gonna go to the king. I'm not gonna go and put myself in that position. So she's not beckoning to his call. So this is on several levels. One, she's no longer just listening to everything he's doing. And two, maybe her loyalties have shifted. Until now, she was Esther, the Bat Avichail, Esther, the Jew. And here we have Esther saying, I am not going to stand up to the king, and I'm not going to listen to you, Mordechai. So we see she's almost looks like maybe she's kind of been subsumed into this Persian identity of being the Persian queen. I'll pause. Okay, so I'm going to, we'll look at Mordechai's reaction in a second. So we see Esther is struggling between these two identities. Now, all of this is fascinating in the historical context of when Esther was presented, when the story of Esther is presented. When does the story of Esther take place? So there is a little bit of dispute among historians, but most historians do think that Ahasuerus is the same king as Xerxes, who lived 486 to 465 BCE. Which means this is after the Chorban Rishon, after the destruction of the first temple, and 30 years after the second temple was already rebuilt. Meaning Esther and Mordechai are the diaspora Jews that chose not to go back when the second Beit HaMikdash was built. When the Jews were allowed to rebuild the Beit HaMikdash, there was a big decree. It went out to all the lands and it said, Jews, come back. We're building the second Beit HaMikdash. Everyone, please come back. This is all, you can read this all in Ezra and Daniel. It's also another wonderful shir to learn Esther in context of the other Sfarim that mention the story. So at that time, 30 years ago, all of the Jews were welcomed back and Esther and Mordechai were part of the Jews that decided not to go. So, and Not just that, but when we look at the accounts of what the Jews were going through 30 years after the second temple is built in Ezra and in Nehemiah and in Daniel and all those different Sfarim, in those different stories, the Jews are in a very dire situation. They're not doing well in Israel. The Beit HaMikdash is one of the Pesukim, I think it's in Ezra, they called them the stragglers, were the ones who came back, meaning the people who are well-established in the other exiled lands, they stayed because they were doing well. And it's the people who didn't that went back to Israel. They were hungry. They weren't doing well. They were really in a dire situation. So it's not just Esther that's struggling with her identity as a Jew and as the Persian princess, but it's also that there's this greater tension of the Jews in Eretz Yisrael and the Jews who are not in Eretz Yisrael. You can see this if you look at the similar language, the way that they describe Achashverosh's palace in the very beginning chapter, and actually part of it we read in an Echa tone because it's the same kind of language that we use to describe the Beit HaMikdash. So, and not just that, but then it describes the same language of Achashverosh's parties, that they're so lavish and they're so over the top, is another very stark contrast to what was going on in the Beit HaMikdash. So not only are the materials in the Persian palace similar to what was in the Beit HaMikdash, but then also the Persians are living it up in this very wealthy and over the top lifestyle, while the Jews in Eretz Yisrael are suffering in a dire situation. And so it just shows this tension between these two epicenters of Judaism, that the Jewish community is struggling with this identity as well, and that Esther is just a microcosm of that that tension. Further with what's just fascinating. So in the third century BCE, the Septuagint is in Greek is a translation of the 70. It refers to the legendary 70 Jewish scholars that were told to translate the Chumash, the five books of Moshe, into Greek. And there are a lot of differences between the Tanakh that we have and what they translated. And one of the major differences in their translation was in the story of Esther, there were six additions that were added. From the Megillah that we have, there were six additions that were added into it. One of them is a prophecy from Mordechai. One of them is a prayer from Mordechai to God and talking to God. One of them is a prayer from Esther, and she's crying out to God. There's a bunch of different additions. And so when Jerome from the Catholic Church in the fourth century CE, several hundred years later, he was translating the Greek Bible into Latin for the church, he realized the disparity between the Masoretic text, what we have, and the Greek versions. And he relegated them to the end of the translation. So today, the Roman Catholic and Eastern Orthodox churches actually still include the additions, but the Protestant church declared them uncanonical and placed them in the Apocrypha, these additions, under the titles Additions to Esther. So again, so I actually brought it. I forgot I have it on the sheet. So here's an example right at the top of page 3. We're going to scroll back to page 2 in a minute, but the top of page 3 is one of the additions from the Septuagint, where it says Queen Esther, being fearful of her death, because Mordechai said the Jewish people are going to be killed, she resorted to God. She turns to the Lord. She weighed away her glorious apparel and put on the garments of anguish and mourning. And instead of precious ointments, she covered her head with ashes and dung, and she humbled her body greatly, and all the places of her joy she filled with her torn hair. And she prayed to the Lord God of Israel, saying, "Oh, my Lord, you are the king. Help me, desolate woman, which have no helper but thee." So much of this is missing in our text. The fact that she's taking off her apparel and putting on, we do see that she cries, and we'll get back to that in a second, but That she's praying to God and it goes through her tefillah. We don't have any of this, which makes it all the more glaring that they added it 2000 years ago, because they felt like when they translated it into Greek, they couldn't send it to the masses and not have God and not have prayer and not have that religious aspect. But it does show that there's a tension in the Sefer of, like, what is the purpose of this Sefer? There's a tension in the fact that she's so Persian, she's so assimilated, and seemingly she's telling Mordechai, I'm the Persian queen. I can't do that. And sorry for the Jewish people, but there's nothing I can do. So how does Mordechai handle it? What does he do? I'm sure he thought about it for a minute. But if we turn back, so if we go back to page 2, chapter 4, Perek Dalet, Pasuk 13, Mordechai is told what Esther said, which is devastating, I'm sure. And in Pasuk 13, Mordechai says, Vayomer Mordechai lehashiv Esther. And he goes, listen, this is what I want you to go back and tell Esther. Al tidami benafshich lehimaleit beit hamelach mikol hayehudim. Don't think that you're going to escape the fate of the Jewish people just because you're in the king's house. You are part of the Jewish people. You come from the Jewish people, and it's going to come back to you no matter what. That just made everything. Did everyone see that? I just turned it somehow. Because it says if you hold your peace, I don't know if that's such a great translation. I would say if you keep quiet, if you do nothing, be'ed hazot at this time, ruach v'hatzala ya'amod la'yehudim imakom acher. It's going to come from somewhere else. Meaning, and it doesn't say this, but it says, you know, it's hinting at God's going to come and save us. Va'at u'beit avicha ta'avodu, but you're still going to be destroyed because you're still a Jew. It will still come back to haunt you. U'miyadei im le'et kazot higite l'machot. And who's going to say that this is the perfect time for you to step in? And who's going to be able to save you that? So Mordechai, getting to the heart of the issue, reminds Esther, you are a Jew, and not only is it upon you to save everyone, but you're not going to escape it. You can't escape this destiny. This is who you are from your core, and this is your root. And we see in the very next pasuk, we'll skip down to section 3, Esther stepping into her own. Esther gets it. She starts to understand, I am a Jew. I can't escape. There is nothing, I wouldn't even say nothing I can do. It's that she owns her identity. And this is a huge moment for her, stepping into her own. Vatomer Esther, and this is Pasuk 15, to speak back to Mordechai. What does she say? She thinks about his words. Lech v'kenot et kol ha-kenos es kol ha-yehudim. Go and gather all of the Jews. Hanimtzaim ba-shushan. Vatsumo elai. They should fast for me. Al tochlu. They shouldn't eat. Va'al tishtu. They shouldn't drink. Shloshet yamim. For 3 days. Laila v'yom. Day and night. V'gam ani v'na'arati. And me and my maidens are going to do it with you. Before, Mordechai is by himself crying and walking around and in sackcloth. And Esther says, I can't do anything for you, and doesn't offer anything. And now she says, I need everyone to fast for me, and I'm going to do it too. And my maidens, she's bringing in her ladies in waiting, her Persian ladies in waiting, into her world. Atzum kein, v'chena vohalach, I will go before the king. Asher lo kedat v'kasher avadati avadati. If I die upon my mission, then I die. So not only is she saying, I'm going to save you, but she says, but if I end up dying in the process, that's just going to happen because I am a Jew, because this is what I realized, this is who I am. And Mordechai is now listening to Esther. He goes, and so she asserts herself. She says, I'm going to go before the king because I am the queen, but I'm going before the king because I'm a Jew and I have to try, and I might die trying. And now Mordechai's the one, before, remember, he was the one commanding her to do this. Don't tell about your identity. And he's commanding her, now this is how you have to choose. She's come into her own. She's asserting herself. And now it's Mordechai who is listening to her and listening to her actions and her words. And now we get to the great big scene. And what I want to look at here is look at all of the different ways it talks about Esther. How does it refer? How does the text refer to her? And what's the title? So, I don't know why that keeps happening. So I skipped ahead a couple chapters of the in-between where Esther kind of sets up a party with Haman and then sets up a party again. This is at the point where she's going before the king and pleading for the Jewish people. But Yomer HaMelech LeEsther, and Esther says, Gam b'yom ha'sheni b'mishteh ha'yayin ma'she'elateich. Mordechai says, Esther, what is it? What's your question? What are we concerned about? So he refers to her as Esther. And he says, ma'she'elateich Esther HaMalka. What is your question, Esther, the queen, the Persian queen? And I'll give it to you. He's like, I'll do anything for you. I love you. Vata'an Esther Hamalka. The Persian queen Esther responds, Vatomer, and she says, Imatzatichin be'enecha. Pasuk Gimel, if I have found favor in your eyes, king, v'im halamelech tov, if it's okay, king, tinatein li nafshi. Please give me my life, va'ami, and my nation. Because she says in Pasuk Dalad, kimnim karuani va'ami, you've tried to sell my people, lahashmid, to be destroyed, laharog, to be killed, la'abed, to perish. Ve'elu avadim l'shifchotim karnu, v'hecharashti. Had I kept my peace, ki ein hatzar shaveh benezek hamelech, I couldn't keep silent anymore. This is what I had to do. I couldn't, and remember, Mordechai uses the words, techarish, techarish, that you shouldn't be quiet. And now she's saying, I couldn't be quiet. I had to save the Jewish people. Vayomer HaMalach HaShverosh, Vayomer LeEsther HaMalka. He still sees her as Esther the queen. He doesn't see her as less. He doesn't see her as Esther the Jew. He says, and the text, it's not even that Mordechai, Achashverosh is seeing her that way. But the king is saying to Esther, the queen, which is how we as the text are addressing her, who's trying to destroy you? Let me address this. This can't be. And as we know, they overturn the edict. She does end up saving the Jewish people. But she does end up saving the Jewish people. The Megillah ends, which I now that we've seen from the very beginning, she's introduced as Hadassah hi Esther, the Jewish name, that's Esther. And then it turns her just into Esther. Now she's Esther Hamalka. But how does it end in the very last chapter? Vatichtov Esther Hamalka, almost at the end, the very end. Vatichtov Esther Hamalka bat Avichail or Mordechai haYehudi. This is her identity coming together. Esther, the queen, the Persian queen, the daughter of Avichail, and Mordechai the Jew. And she writes down all of the events of what happens, and she sends out letters to all of the different provinces that everyone should hear what happened and everyone should rejoice that the Jewish people were saved. So I just love this pasuk because it shows you this semblance of she was struggling, that she was so the sheltered Jewish woman. And then she kind of threw herself into the Persian light and didn't feel like she could do anything. And then she found this inner bravery and she came into her own. And by the end of the Sefer, we're presenting her as this woman who struggled with these two identities, and she's miyashev them. She's able to bring them together to be the Esther, the Malka, but also to be the Jew and to be proud, of who she is. So getting back though to some of our original questions to end everything, there's still no God. It's still a very assimilated book in that there's no religion. She stays intermarried, which actually stays an issue. She doesn't say I'm a Jew and I'm supposed to be married to a Jew. She actually just stays intermarried. She, and if it is Xerxes, Xerxes had Darius, so she had children with him. The story is inviting the reader into the messy world of navigating and negotiating what life is like in exiled, to be an exiled Jew, to be living in a culture that's not yours, and to be living in a religion that might not be yours. And the book of Esther shows an understanding, and understands the challenges well of living in a world where one has to juggle and negotiate conflicting identities and loyalties, maybe politics or ethnic and religious identities. So it's certainly a book for one of the last books to be canonized, because it's almost like this message and this hope and this chizuk, for knowing that we're not going to have the Beis HaMikdash forever, that we have something to look to when we might not be living in the land of Eretz Yisrael, or we're in the land of Eretz Yisrael and we're still struggling with peace, and we're still struggling with, Bezras Hashem, this is Reshit Tzmicha Gulatenu, this is the beginning, but it's just the beginning and we're still struggling, that it's important to be proud to be Jewish, and to fight for your people, to know your religious freedoms and to exert them. And the fact that God is not mentioned in the Sefer, he is so clearly present. And Mordechai, when he even says, if you're not going to be the savior, it's going to come from somewhere else. They believed it was going to come from somewhere else. Without almost saying God's name, you know that he's there. However, the narrative doesn't want to trivialize the will, power, and the strength that it took Esther to be the Jewish person. And that we, as Jews, without a Beit HaMikdash, and now we're living in America, it's almost saying, don't rest on your laurels. You can't just depend on God. He's not going to present everything to a silver platter. Like Esther had to fight for her identity and for her freedom and for her people, we too have to fight for who we are as Jewish people. I certainly think there's just been such an uptick in anti-Semitism of late, of the past couple of years. It can be scary to wear the Jewish identity on your sleeve, but Esther's story is showing the importance of being able to feel strong in your Jewish identity, even in exile, and that there can be this way of balancing both worlds, balancing both identities, and that we are able to, and I think certainly as a community, to be able to uplift each other, to hold both identities dear and not sacrifice one for the other. So I could stop share. Hold on one second. I'm going to stop share. There we go. So I had a lot of fun getting to know Esther, seeing Esther come into her own as her identity. And I hope, I certainly found a lot of inspiration from Esther as a modern Jew in 2022, of being proud to, of very much saying, I am a Jew and this is who I am, and not going to apologize for it. So I hope everyone else feels the same inspiration as well as we head into Purim in a few weeks. I'm gonna stop the recording. So if anyone wants to ask any questions, they are welcome.